In his book, Alex's Adventures in Numberland, Alex Bellos speaks to a linguist and expert of the Munduruku, an indigenous people of Brazil. The Munduruku don't have words for numbers greater than five, as anyone would. Alex asks questions about how the Munduruku navigate practical problems involving numbers. For example, how would one go about asking for enough fish to feed six people? It's impossible, the linguist said. The sentence, "I want fish for six people," doesn't exist. I tell this story because it illustrates that numbers are a tool we've created or discovered in order to do things. Our system of numbers has evolved over many centuries to become what it is today, and in this video, we'll take a look at that system. In my opinion, our most fundamental use of numbers is for comparing quantities in order to make decisions in the real world. Three apples is more than two apples, this job has a higher salary than that job, and so on. We use relations less than or equal to, greater than or equal to, and equal to compare numbers. And for any two numbers, each of these relations will be either true or false. The fact that we can compare any two numbers means we can place all the numbers on a line with smaller numbers to the left and larger numbers to the right. Consequently, any number to the right of another must be the larger of the two. We say that numbers are well ordered because each number has its own place on the number line. This ordering leads to an important consequence. For any numbers A, B and C, if A is less than B and B is less than C, then we can conclude that A must be less than C. This is known as a transitive property, and we use it all the time without ever really thinking about it. For example, let's say the weather is warmer in Paris than in Stockholm, and in Cairo, the weather is warmer than in Paris. By the transitivity of temperature, we can deduce that it must be warmer in Cairo than in Stockholm. We call the whole numbers 1 to infinity the natural numbers because they arise from our natural need to count things, like how many slices there are in a pizza. When mathematicians make statements about numbers, we usually refer to them as in sets, and so we would refer to them as the set of natural numbers. And we use this barred capital N symbol as a shorthand to the set of natural numbers. And we might draw a diagram like this to represent the set of natural numbers. We also change our language to say 1 belongs to n, which we can write with this symbol, which means belongs to. And this feels like a much more precise statement than saying 1 is a number. We can also partition the set of natural numbers into subsets representing categories of numbers which share specific properties. For example, the even numbers and the odd numbers are both subsets of the natural numbers. The natural numbers themselves are a subset within a whole ecosystem of sets of numbers. And for the rest of this video, we'll look in detail at the various kinds of numbers shown here. An important concept we need to introduce is that the natural numbers are closed under addition and multiplication. This means that if you take two numbers in N and add them or multiply them together, you'll always end up with another number in n. But subtracting one natural number from another doesn't guarantee you'll get another natural number back. The integers we denote with a barred z after Zahlen, the German word for numbers, extend the natural numbers in the negative direction, meaning the integers are closed under subtraction as well as addition and multiplication. And since every natural number is also an integer, we say that the natural numbers are a subset of the integers. The word rational is derived from ratio, and a rational number is defined as any a divided by b, where a and b are integers. And b isn't zero, since dividing any number by zero isn't really allowed. The set of natural numbers is given the symbol q after the word quotient. Since any integer can be written as itself divided by 1, for example, 23 over 1 is just 23, the integers are a subset of the rational numbers, but the behaviour of the rationals is completely different to integers. For example, the distance between any two integers must be at least 1, but we can get rational numbers arbitrarily close together. To prove this, let's take two rationals, a over b and c over d. We can actually find another rational number halfway between them by adding them together and then dividing by 2. We can even use the same trick to get another rational halfway between a and b and the new one. And carrying this on an infinite number of times will get us infinitely close to a over b. Question time. Which is bigger, 38 over 43 or 117 over 134? Using a decimal expansion, it becomes clear which is bigger. In our base 10 system, this means expressing fractions in powers of 10. The Pythagoreans of ancient Greece believed that all numbers are rational, and the discovery of irrational numbers, numbers that aren't rational, is attributed to Hippasus of Metapontum, who himself was a Pythagorean. One legend says that he made the discovery whilst at sea, and the Pythagoreans were so enraged they threw him overboard. The irony is that Pythagoras' theorem itself can lead us directly to irrational numbers. So Pythagoras' theorem says that for a right-angled triangle with sides of lengths A, B and C, where C is the hypotenuse, the line opposite the right angle, then the lengths of the sides have the relationship A squared plus B squared equals C squared. So let's consider a right-angled triangle with sides A and B of length 1. We find that the hypotenuse is of length square root of 2. Now this is a perfectly fine triangle, nothing wrong here. So we'll go ahead and we'll assume that the square root of 2 exists and, as the Pythagoreans believed, is rational. If the square root of 2 is rational, we can write it down as a divided by b, where a and b are just some integers. Let's assume any common factors have been taken out, so a over b is in its simplest form. We'll play around with the algebra and see where this leads us. Squaring both sides, we get 2 equals a squared over b squared, which implies that 2 times b squared equals a squared, and so a must be even. Bear in mind that if the square of a number is even, then the number itself must be even. Okay, so if A is even, we can let A equals 2 times K, where K is just some other integer. Plugging this back into the equation gives us 2 times B squared equals 2 times K all squared, which means 2 times B squared equals 4K squared. Or dividing both sides by 2, we get B squared equals 2 times K squared. So B must also be even. Okay, so we start with A over B in its simplest form, but the algebra has showed us that they actually both had the common factor of 2. This is a contradiction, and it implies something was wrong with our assumptions to begin with. It's worth going over this again because this method of proof by contradiction is one of the most common methods of proving theorems in maths. To prove a theorem, like the square root of 2 is irrational, you start by first assuming the opposite of the thing you're trying to prove is true, and that your theorem is false. You then follow the logical implications, and if you reach a contradiction, then your original assumption was false, and so the theorem must be true. Together, the rationals and the irrationals form a set called the real numbers, denoted by a barred capital R symbol. The real numbers are said to be complete since there are no points on the number line which aren't either rational or irrational. Any single point on the line is a real number. Now remember that the natural numbers are closed under addition and multiplication. That is, adding or multiplying any two natural numbers together gives you another. But the natural numbers aren't closed under subtraction. because you can end up with a negative integer. And we have a similar situation with the integers which aren't closed under division. Well, when we get to the real numbers, we can add, multiply, subtract, and divide all we like, and we always get another real. We say the real numbers form a field under the operations addition and multiplication. The subtract and divide operations are not explicitly mentioned because technically they're the inverse of addition and multiplication. And the same is true for all rational numbers, which also form a field with respect to addition and multiplication. The various characteristics of numbers we've talked about in this video will come up time and time again in your maths journey. For example, the study of natural numbers leads to number theory, the study of operations on each of these sets leads to abstract algebra, and the characteristics of real numbers, namely completeness, leads to real analysis and is the foundation of calculus. There are numbers beyond these. In fact, the real numbers belong to an even larger set called the complex numbers. But that's a story for another time. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.